Hello, and welcome back to another episode with It's Dr. Dan. Today we're going to be learning how to convert D and L glucose from a Fischer to a Haworth projection. Now, what makes this so different than my previous videos on Haworth projections is that D and L are enantiomers of one another, meaning that the Haworth projection is going to end up being flipped because of that enantiomer shape. So we're going to go through this step by step and show exactly how to do this for glucose. First thing that we're going to do is have our Fischer projection. And I have the OHs here labeled in red so you can see the difference and make it a little bit easier. So we're going to first start by drawing the enantiomer. Now, when we go through this and draw that enantiomer, remember that entire thing, the way to look at that is this is a mirror image or a reflection, right? So it's just like yourself. You're looking in the mirror and you're waving at yourself. So the first thing that I would do is I would redraw that general backbone, just like how we have before. And the things that are going to be mirrored that are the important parts are the OHs because they are on those chiral carbons, right? So we have a chiral carbon here, 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 and here. Those are all shown by those different crosses. So when we are writing that, we are going to fill in, I always like to start with the OHs. So that way you're just going to fill in the important functional group, and each one of these is paired with a hydrogen. So there's a hydrogen on one side, OH on the other. So I'll write down maybe like one side. So like on the left, I have OH, H, OH, OH. And then I'll write all the pairs on the right side, just like so. So we have our enantiomer. Now, what exactly does that mean? So that means on the right side, I now have L glucose for the other structure. How can you tell if it's L or D? Well, the way to remember if it's L or D has to do with the last chiral carbon. So if we kind of go through these, right, each one of these here, like I said, are chiral. And what we're going to do is we're going to look at the last one in the line. So the one I put a little red star next to, this is the last one. And what we can see is, well, on the left structure, the OH is on the right side. So for D, for dexter. So D is on the right, and that is going to be R, right, or D. Now on the bottom one, we have L is on the left. So L here, we will denote that with the letter L to say that this is left. So D and L. Now let's go on to our next step. All right, so our next step is all about rotating the Fischer projection. So for this, I already went through the process of rotating it. What we will do is we're going to rotate it 90 degrees to the right. Now the reason why we're doing this is so that it helps us see a couple things. The first one is we want to make sure that we keep all of our carbons numbered. It's really important to see where all your OHs are going to be going because it matters if they're top or bottom on your final structure. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So we have all those individual numbers. Now, what is also important about top and bottom here is what I mean is notice how we have some OHs on the bottom of our structure. So if we kind of imagine a little border line that we have here, we have some that are on the bottom, some that are on the top. So what we'll do is we will label that. So this is going to be top, and in green, we are going to have bottom. And it's going to be the same idea too for the other structure or the enantiomer. So for D and L, we will keep our same idea. We'll number it as well, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And we will also have our top and bottom for L. And you can see already that both of these are flipped as a result of R being a different isomer. So all the OHs for the L one are all going to be pointing, most of them are going to be pointing up. Whereas you can see for D, most of them are pointing down. So it's going to be a really big difference in our structure. Let's look at the next step. For step three, what makes this so different is that we need to be able to figure out how big is our ring going to be. Most monosaccharides or simple sugars are generally a 5 or a 6-member ring, meaning it's going to be one of these two shapes that I have written down here. Now, the one thing that's different about the numbering here is notice that I have a number on our oxygen on the ring. These are both considered to be heterocyclic rings, okay? Being that hetero meaning different. So what makes it heterocyclic is that it has a oxygen embedded in the ring. So whenever we have a heterocyclic species, that means we have something different. So when we are going through these, we're going to have to number them. Before, I had it just by numbering the carbons, right? We started at the carbonyl, we numbered all the way down. We're going to do the same idea, but this is what I always call an unofficial numbering, because all we want to know is how big our ring is when we go through this. So once again, we're going to start at the C double bond O. So always at the carbonyl is your first number. Regardless of if it's an aldose or a ketose, we are going to start at this one for just how big is the ring. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And then we're going to that last chiral carbon. So we're going to put a little red star next to it again. And our last numbered spot is going to be the oxygen that is on the last alcohol. All right, so that's going to be 6. Meaning that this structure is going to have the same shape as the one on the top left. So we will have our 6-member ring, just like so. And it's going to have an OH on the structure, and it's going to look something like this. And we can redraw the numbering on here. It's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And that 6 oxygen that's here on this ring comes from this chiral spot. And if you came here to figure out mechanisms, go to my hemiacetal and acetal video. I will go through the mechanism of how to do this. This is more how to draw Haworth projections quickly. So now it's the same idea for this other structure. It's going to be the same thing. Being that they're both enantiomers, their skeletal structure is still the same. It's the chirality is the different part. So we're only putting the ring here. It's only the carbons that we're interested in. So both of these structures are going to be that 6-member ring. So let's go on to our next step here. All right, step 4 is all about where to place all of your OH groups. So previously I mentioned that it's very important that we go through and number our rings because we need to make sure that we are placing everything in the right spot. So let's first start with the OH groups. So if we notice, we have this general shape. So we have our hemiacetal structure. We have our anomeric carbon that is on number 1. So we'll talk about the anomeric carbon in a little bit. That's just, we're just going to place that facing up in the meantime. So now for our next groups, we're going to put in red all of our OH groups. So we're going to go from carbon to carbon. So carbon 1 was the aldehyde that turned into an alcohol. Now carbon 2, the OH is pointing down, right? So being that we see that downward, we're going to fill that in going down as well. We're now going to move to carbon 3. Carbon 3, we see that it is on the top side. So being that this is top, we are going to go through and we're going to put it going up. Now carbon 4, we see that it is going down, so we're going to fill that in as well. Now carbon 5 is different than all the others. Now why is that? Well, if you remember from your reactions here, this particular carbon, this one is where this OH is what's doing the bonding. So that OH there, let's color code that for ourselves. So this OH, how about green? So being that we have our green O, that one is what is going to become a part of the ring structure itself. So something happens here. When this chain opened, or right before it closed, it goes through a process known as mutarotation, which can cause this last CH2 group here that's on carbon number 6 to rotate either up or down. Now, how do you know where it's going to go? Because we have 6 carbons. So on carbon 5, we have a CH2OH group that's going to be pointing either up or down. And it has to do with whether or not it was D or L. So if it was D, it's going to be pointing up. If it was L, it's going to be pointing down. So we're going to put that in. So we have a CH2OH, and it's going to be pointing up. And we can see that here. Now, what's the difference between what we were doing before? Well, if we go to the other structure for L, so that's down here, how are they going to compare? Well, L, we're going to go through the entire process of filling everything in. So if we start at carbon number one, so let's go through and renumber everything. So we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then carbon number 6. We're numbering our carbons this time because we already know our ring size, so official numbering. So the first thing is, where does the CH2OH go? Let's start with that one, like how we did last time. Well, being that it is L, is this time it's going to be pointing down as a result. So what we're going to do is, in our structure, we are going to have a CH2OH inside, like so, pointing down, and we are going to write it like so. And here, let's make this ink size a little bit smaller, so that way we can see it a little bit better. So CH2OH, all right? So that's pointing down on carbon number 5. Now, for the other carbons, what is going to be so different is we're going to do the same thing. We're going to go through this, and we're going to put our OH is pointing up and down, going carbon to carbon. So carbon 2, we have up, carbon 3 is down, carbon 4 is up. So up, down, up. It's like kind of having a cheat code in a game. So we have up, down, and then up. And that is what our structure would look like. Now, comparing the two, so if I bring the other one down, we can see that the OH groups are flipped between the different structures. Notice how the top one is, if we go through here, we see down, up, down between 2, 3, and 4. And on the other structure, it's up, down, up. So this is the difference between whenever we have a D structure and an L structure for these two pieces. Let's go on to the last little bit about alpha and beta anomers. Step 5 in the final step is all about alpha and beta anomers, which tends to be one of the most confusing parts for going over carbohydrates. Now, why is that? Well, mainly it's because both alpha and beta can exist. Now, what is an alpha or a beta? Well, it's all about looking at the anomeric carbon. So for all of these, the anomeric carbon is wherever we have a hemiacetal, meaning that we are looking for an ether and an alcohol connected to the same spot. Or on a disaccharide, this could be also the acetal or the ketal. So on this structure, the one thing that we are seeing is it's all about where are the CH2 and the CH2OH, where are they facing? So we are always looking at two areas. So if I have right down below, I have both D-glucose and L-glucose. In order to tell if something is beta, so beta is all about, beta is cis, alpha is trans. So what exactly are we referring to with cis and trans? Because usually people think about double bonds. So for something to be cis, the CH2OH and your anomeric OH must either both be pointing up, like a touchdown or a field goal, or they must be both be pointing down. Now on trans, well, you might be able to guess it. Well, if they're both pointing down or up together for beta or cis, they're the same. On trans, it's all about, well, if one of them is pointing, let's say, up, the other one is going to be pointing down. Okay, so think of these kind of like little arrows, pointing up, pointing down. Now, in order for something to be the opposite, right, for the other side, it's the same general thing. If one's pointing up, the other one must be pointing down for CH2OH on the other side. So if we were to kind of look at all those structures above, we can further classify each of these individual rings here that we have. Now, if we look at the first one on the left-hand side, what do you see? Well, the CH2OH is pointing up, and the OH itself is also pointing up. And in fact, we can even draw this so that way it is pointing up, so that way it helps illustrate up and up for you. right? Because that is the correct way. So being that is the case, this is technically beta D glucose because of that rotation. Now for this other one, you can see that, oh, well, we have an OH that's pointing up, and we have our CH2OH on the inside of the ring is pointing down. So this is referred to as alpha L glucose. Now, how do you know if it's alpha or beta? How do you know where this OH went? Because I just put it going up. It can also be going down as well. The reason is, going back up here, is the ring is able to reopen itself. It can open and close. Now, when this happens, the OH could rotate where it's either pointing up or it's pointing down as a result. In fact, with most carbohydrates in the body, 63% of them exist as beta, the other 37 act as alpha. So now, how do you know with your problems? Most of the time, it's generally specified in homework and exam problems which one to draw. And if not, they might ask you to draw both. So for this problem, you can see that we did alpha and beta here. So if let's say if we just copy and paste this here, how would you draw the other? Well, it's all about just flipping that OH. So if we erase here and here, so in order to do the other, it would just be all about, well, before we had beta D. So if we make alpha D, we can see, oh, hey, the OH is down, so that's alpha D. And then beta L, you would have them both being pointing in the same direction. So now they're both pointing down as a result. And we can just flip the OH. And that's all you have to do. They both exist naturally in your body, and they both get metabolized different ways because of alpha or beta or L or D. They all have different purposes for what they're going to be used for. That's this video on how to do Haworth projections for both L and D. I hope this helped you. Please keep hit that like and subscribe button if it did, and comment below. Let me know what you thought. All the comments, I love answering them, and I love hearing back from you guys. All right, thank you so much, and I hope you have a wonderful day, and I'll see you all later. Bye now.